Good morning, friends. Today I'm going to talk about the contract law. This is an introductory lecture on contract law, and we will have a very detailed lecture in the subsequent lecture series. So as of the lecture, this is going to introduce the contract law from an economic analysis perspective. So this is also the 8th lecture. So I hope all of you will enjoy it. So so far what we have worried about is actually right, and we haven't talked about the different issues related with business or anything of that sort, or even the accidental problems. But roughly we just come across all that. Depend on different contexts. So today we are largely, and especially when we talk about economics, there is a lot of transaction takes place between parties, and obviously all of us know that these transactions are either based on a sort of an informal or an formal binding. So contract is all about all this thing. So we will be seeing that what systematically the mechanism in which we try to, you know, incorporate this problem as a lecture. So when two parties want to reallocate rights, say for I want to buy your used car, or you want to buy my permission to have an OC party, or neighbors want to pay a all these are actually the kind of problems, daily problems we encounter, and we can assume that all this can be done by people. All right, so one or the other way they definitely can. So some transaction happens all at once. For example, I hand you a check of some money, let's say $3,500. What you have to do in return is you hand me the key of your car. So there might be search cost, there may be bargaining cost, there may be also an enforcement if time depends on different circumstances. So these being the transaction cost, and but some don't have this kind of problem. So that is like neighbor pay the factory to pollute less going forward. Need to make sure factory stick to the agreement. What if technology change and factory won't start polluting more again? All those kind of questions can immediately arise. These are all the questions which is normally happens posteriori, not a priori. So while we enter into the negotiation, this problem may not be there. So this is what is actually a contracts are for. All right. So a contract in that sense, in a simplistic way, it's a promise, as all of us know, which is legally binding. That is the most important part of this. That is a point of contract to enable trade when transactions are concluded immediately. That is why we need to actually have a contract, because there is a transaction cost involved even after concluding of the business. That is why we need a contract. For example, the agency trust game is a classic case of it. That is, suppose if there is two players, that is player one, that is somebody who is going to do business, who is having capital, but at the same time he is not the person who is going to do business. Business is being done by somebody else who doesn't have capital, but who is actually can do business. So this is actually the two player, player one and two. Player one is you, that is the person who is having capital. Now, what is your option? You have two options: trust me or don't trust me. So if you don't trust me, there is no business at all in the very beginning. But if you trust me, what happens? If you don't trust me, you keep your money and I have nothing. Alright, if you trust me, then I have options. Alright, means you are going to give me money. So in that case, I have actually at least two possibility: share profit with you or keep all the money with me. So these are the two possibilities, immediate possibility. Now if I keep all the money with me, then I would, in fact, let's assume that I'll double the profit. So I'll double the amount. So if I double the amount, I'll keep all the double amount. You get nothing. So if I share profit, then what happens? I'll give you your money, invested amount, plus the profit. At the same time, I'll keep 50. So 50% of that. Let's say it's 50 rupees. So what is my dominant strategy? I'll get only 50. If I'll keep, I'll get 500. So what would be my dominant strategy? I'll keep all the money. So what would be then your? So the other person, irrespective of whether I'm going to share it or not, his dominant strategy is, if I play this dominant strategy of 200, then you get nothing. So what is your best strategy? Your best strategy is going to be actually keeping all the money and no business. So the reality, this is called a subgame perfect. You will never have a business at all. You don't have trust. Okay? Because this is a trust game. In the trust game, in the very beginning itself, you understand that if the other person has all the possibility of keeping all the money, so you end up with nothing. So subgame perfect equilibrium, I'll keep all the money, so you don't trust me. So inefficient outcome is the result. That is, 100 is always in the economics less than 200. So in economics, we prefer more to less, right? So if that is the case, then 200 is obviously greater than 100. In that case, I won't actually in an equilibrium. I won't be in equilibrium, because my equilibrium, even if I'm in equilibrium, my equilibrium is always sub. It's suboptimal. So and we are both worse off in that sense. So what is actually the solution? Reputation, trust. Okay. So another solution is called the legal binding. The reputation is actually informal. For example, you know that the Maghreb traders or Coptic Christian traders or the Maghreb Muslim traders or many different parts of the world, people have different sort of trade culture. For example, if they made a promise, then they will be actually fulfilling that promise at any point of time by them or the person, their progeny. So this is a kind of actually the reputation game operates. And the solution to that is what is called a legally binding promise. Okay, because the earlier one is actually called the informal sort of thing, and now there is a legality involved, and that legally binding thing can actually change things. This is how we need contracts. So let us play 1 and 2 and all the game intact. That is, now if you keep all the money, that is the legally binding thing is comes with this thing. So if keep all the money, then I'll be ending up with 2 penalty, say some amount, which is actually out of my point. Because contract writing, we both have this involved, and that will be say for 25. If I keep the money, then I have to I receive only 25 instead of 15. Oh, okay. So what happens if I share profit? I may be actually benefiting by 50. So 25 and 50, then I would always look into the number. So I'll go for sharing the profit rather than default. So in that sense, if you have a legal binding, definitely you will have actually a profitability, and now we get cooperation and efficiency. So the contract made us cooperate. So purpose of the contract law: to allow trade in situation where this requires credible promises. Now what type of promise should be enforced by law? This is an immediate question, you know, comes in everyone's mind. So the question is, for example, I would be liking to present a few cases, and then we will discuss about which one is actually an enforceable promise or law. So suppose the rich uncle, this is an example from Kuchinwe, the rich uncle of a struggling college student learns at the graduation party that his nephew graduated with honors. Swept away by good feeling, the uncle promised the nephew a trip around the world. Later the uncle reneges on his promise. The student sues his uncle, asking the court to compel the uncle to pay for a trip around the world. The second case is, one neighbor offers to sell a used car to another for $1,000. The buyer gives money to the seller and the seller gives the car key to the buyer. To her great surprise, the buyer discovers that the key fits the rusting Chevrolet in the backyard, not the shiny Cadillac in this driveway. The seller is equally surprised to learn that buyer expects the Cadillac. The buyer asks the court to order the seller to turn over the Cadillac. This is the second case. And this is the third case which is we're going to discuss, because these cases are going to be thoroughly discussed throughout the contract lecture. So the third one is, a farmer, in response to magazine ad for a sure means to kill grasshopper, mails $25 and receive in the mail two wooden block with the instruction, place grasshopper on the block A and smash with the block B. So the buyer asked the court to require the seller to return $25 and pay $500 in punitive damage. So to develop these examples and its rationalizing, we first see what is a bargaining theory of contract. Before coming to the other nitty-gritty of this thing, let us first go for a theory which is we normally study in the contract theory, which is called the bargaining theory of contract. So what is a bargaining theory of contract? So it is a contract theory developed in the late 1800s and of course the early 1900s. So between this period, this theory was evolved. A promise, according to the theory, a promise should be enforced if it was given as part of a bargain, otherwise it should not. So this is very plain and simple. A promise should be enforced if it was given as part of a bargain, otherwise it should not. So what is bargain? Were taken to have three elements in that sense. What is a bargain? Bargain is in that sense having three elements: A, offer; B, acceptance; C, consideration. So I mean, in this three case, we know it's offer is plain and somebody who has to offer. Acceptance means somebody has to accept the offer. So this is a reciprocal or a mutual thing. But there is a third thing which is very important, which is called a consideration. So what is consideration in that sense? So a consideration has its own characterization. So a promiser, person who gives promise, a promisee, person who receives. So we have an offer as well as an acceptance in that sense. So in a bargaining, both sides must give up something. So this is what is called a reciprocal inducement. Consideration is what the promise gives to the promiser in exchange for the promise. Now, under bargaining theory, a contract becomes enforceable once consideration is given. So this is very, very important. And immediately, let us go back to the examples which we try to talk about. So when the rich uncle promised his nephew a trip around the world, no consideration was given. The nephew did not give him anything to induce a promise. So under bargaining, the promise is not enforceable. So Promises of gifts are generally not enforceable under the bargaining theory, since the promisee is not giving anything as inducement, and therefore the promise is not part of bargaining. But this is very important to look into, because there are other theories of the contract which may have a very different take on this. That is why we are trying to bring this example as well as these theories, to see that how the situation and theory changes the very outcome of the problem, or we say case, in the case law countries. So in the example of dispute card, although consideration was given, that is the condition of offer and acceptance were not met, but there is another problem, that is actually meeting of the mind problem. So since the seller was offering one thing and the buyer was expecting another one, in Kutrunulan's word, without meeting of mind there is no offer and no acceptance, just a failure to communicate. So this is very plain in that sense. Therefore that the second example also is not actually considered. And the third example, the seller offers a method for killing grasshoppers. The buyer accepted the offer and the payment of $25 acted as consideration. So under the bargaining, this was valid promise and therefore enforceable. So somebody had offered, the other person accepted, and then there is a money has sent. So it implies that for a reciprocal nature, it is enforceable. But what is that level of enforcement is a very different question altogether. So we will come to that also later. So keep these three examples which are going to be frequently referred in the coming lectures also. So the bargaining does not distinguish between fair and unfair bargain in that sense, very plain. Okay, this is a hell of an example which normally people try to bring in the law and economics literature. For example, Hammer versus Sudway, New York Appeal Court in 1891. This is a famous case which was quoted in many textbooks. So uncle offered nephew this $5,000 to give up drinking and smoking until his 21st birthday, then refused to pay. So this is a very, very important one. The promisee, that is, previously used tobacco, occasionally drank liquor, and he had a legal right to do so. That right he abandoned for a period of a year upon the strength of the promise. That is, we need not speculate on the effort which may have been required to give up the use of these stimulants. It is sufficient that he restricted his lawful freedom of action within certain prescribed limit upon the faith of his uncle's agreement, and now having fully performed the condition imposed. It is of no moment whether such performance actually proved a benefit to the promisor, and the court will not inquire into it. So this is what is. Under the bargaining theory, what is the remedy? X. So this is a very tough question altogether, being placed while Hammer and Sidbe case was being referred in the court. We will discuss more about this case in the coming lectures. So under a bargaining theory, what is remedy? So expectation damage, this is the first kind of remedy. The amount of benefit the promisee could reasonably expect from performance of the promise. So how much we have given or how much we will be giving if there is a breach, etc., is a case which is connected to this thing. So expectation damage is the first sort of a damage which normally people try to get. That is the amount of benefit the promisee could reasonably expect from performance of the promise. So meant to make the promisee as well as he could have been, or he would have been if the promise had been fulfilled. So this is that case. And again, if you have a problem with the bargaining, then what are these issues? Not that accurate a description of what modern courts actually do. Not always efficient. These are the two points. So, does not enforce certain promises that both promisor and promisee might have wanted to be enforced. So, as we noted that the fair and unfair things cannot be considered under the bargaining same. Same is actually with the wanting or somebody wanted to, both the promisor and promisee want to enforce it, but the court cannot be under the bargaining theory. So does enforce certain promise that may should not be enforced. At the same time, some people may not be liking to enforce the things, but under the bargaining theory it can actually impose an enforcement. For efficiency, what promise should be enforced? So this is the question normally economists try to argue. That is, when should or when a promise should enforced? So this is the question. So normally we, in the previous lecture, we have seen that, you know, when it is efficient, you have to enforce. So what promise should be enforced is the question which we are going to discuss next. So in general, efficiency requires enforcing a promise if both the promisor and the promisee want to be enforced. When it was made, that is different from wanting it to actually be enforced. So the first purpose of the contract law is to enable people to cooperate by converting games with non-cooperative solution into games with cooperative solution, or enable people to convert games with inefficient equilibria into games with efficient equilibria. So now we know what promise should be enforced. That is, for efficiency, enforce those which both promisor and promisee want to be enforceable when they were made. So the purpose of contract law, therefore, is to enable cooperation by changing a game to have a cooperative solution. A contract law can serve a number of other purposes as well. So it is not only the cooperative thing which it creates. Definitely a contract is actually for cooperation, to enable cooperation. So this is one of the fundamental understanding normally people try to inculcate. But at the same time, as we said earlier, that there are other purposes also. So one is actually information, that is private or asymmetric information can hinder trade. Therefore, maybe contract can overcome this problem. So this is actually the case which Akerlof was brought out in his Market for Lemon paper, especially the car market case. So a contract law could help. Therefore, you could offer me a legally binding warranty. At the same time, it is also ensures people's security or kind of assurance that what they had promised may be going to be kept. So this is a kind of warranty. Or contract law could impose on you an obligation to tell me what you know about the condition of the car. So forcing you to share information is efficient, since it makes us more likely to trade. So these are the purposes which is other than the cooperation. Obviously, these are strands of other aspects of this contract. Strands or other aspects of this contract. So the second purpose of the contract law is to encourage the efficient disclosure of information within the contractual relationship. So the next question is, if a contract is a promise, what should happen when promise get broken? This is what is called the breach of contract. Okay, could be I signed a contract with no intention of living up to it, but could be I signed a contract in good faith, intended to keep it, or but circumstances change and making performance of the contract less desirable, maybe even inefficient. So these are the questions normally people asked about the breach. So what should happen to me if I fail to perform is the question which we have to discuss in the coming lecture. So thank you for this short listening, the short lecture. So I'll be introducing the same, the continuation of the same in the coming lecture.